Hello, my name is John Trefethen. With me today is Robin Lasser, an artist who deals specifically with the notions of text and image as it relates to the landscape, as discussed in your text. Hello, Robin.
Hello, John.
I've asked several people the same question, and I want to know what your thoughts are. So, what comes to mind when you think of the term landscape?
Well, I can tell you what comes to mind when I think about how I work with a landscape in my art production. I tend to think of the landscape as anything outside of myself. I think of the landscape as a public instead of a private space. And with the kind of work I create, I work with that landscape's history, its politics, or its social practice.
The earliest work I'm familiar with is your work that deals with the consumption of our land. How did you come to this work?
Well, I've worked in the landscape since about 1979, and my practice is to basically build sets and photograph them in the landscape. And for many years, the kind of work I created was responding to the landscape's spiritual essence, so to speak. But as I trained my 4x5 camera on that landscape, I'd have to be blind not to notice what's happening in addition to the spiritual presence of the landscape, and that is our ravaging and consumption of the landscape. So I started this series, which I call Consuming in the Landscapes, which are these large 10-foot eating utensils that are built and placed in the landscape, and it's a combination of their presence with the environment where the meaning is created, and thus the photographic presence.
And a lot of the objects that were photographed were actually made from the materials that were being either extracted from that location or were elements that were kind of being utilized to strip the earth away. Am I correct in assuming that?
Not really. So what I do, though, is I'll go out into the landscape and I'll take notes and do research, come back, and in my studio I try to fabricate something that looks like it's growing out of that landscape. An example might be in Mono Lake, where all the tufas are growing out of the waters. I created the utensils to look like they were giant tufas. And I do that as a way of camouflaging the work in the landscape so that our assumptions about what belongs there or not are almost inverted. I've had people say to me, oh, the sculptures look realer than the landscape itself.
Well, let's go back to the very beginning. Where were you born?
I was born in Buffalo, New York.
Interesting. Well, how long were you there?
About a month.
Quite the heritage. And you quickly moved to California?
To Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and then on from there to La Jolla, because my father was working at UCSD. And really that move for me was an essential one, and a lot of the work that I create now is more or less influenced by that move to Southern California.
So that transition itself was an impact somehow in your life?
Yeah, I was 12 years old and we moved from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania to La Jolla, and I remember moving there and I went from an environment which was smokestacks and metal and dust and dirt to one of high sunshine, blue waters, dolphins, and you know, people in their beautiful bikinis and their beautiful bodies, and somehow I felt that it was fake and that I didn't belong. And, you know, I slowly developed an eating disorder, anorexia nervosa. And later in life, I revisited that history and did a project called Eating Disorders in a Disordered Culture. As I think of it, the consuming landscapes probably had something to do with it, too. Large utensils out in the landscape all about our insatiable hungers, yeah.
At what point did you decide, or was it a decision, to become an artist? Or did you just sort of begin making art and then you adopted the quote-unquote artist title?
No. When I was in high school, I loved making art. And it was the time and space where everything else disappeared. 6 hours would go by and it felt like a moment. But like a lot of young people, my parents discouraged me from becoming an artist because they said, how are you going to make a living? And besides, you can't draw. So when I entered UCLA, I entered as a psych major because I thought, well, what's the next best thing? I'm interested in people, so psychology might be interesting. but then statistics came along, and I thought, no, I'm going to go back to those art classes. Really, I think when you have that desire and motivation, it's hard to, at least it was hard for me to deny it. And I started taking design classes at UCLA and then photography classes.
Okay. Something you said reminds me of that transitional period. So your work went from sort of consuming our landscape to more about consuming ourselves. And we know anorexia nervosa is actually a process of consuming yourself, where the body sort of turns inward. But that work you created, Eating Disorders in a Disordered World, was a very public piece. It was displayed in the public, but more importantly, it involved the public and their reaction on multiple levels, some of those being online interaction, others being offline interaction. And I just want to ask you, was that formulated? Did you think that through, or did that involvement happen?
The project really has three venues, and one is a installation format where we have sound, sculpture, photograph, and text. The other is a public art, so to speak, or temporary public art, and that's in the form of large-scale billboards that might be 48 feet long and 12 feet high, or transit posters in New York City. And then we have a website for an online presence. And we were very calculating in our decision to work in these three venues because I think you can really affect an audience differently in each of those sites. And I can tell you our thoughts about that a little bit if you want.
Yeah, share this.
Okay.
I think, I mean, this class we deal with online space and the working model behind social media, and that's a public... There's a public discourse that takes place there that can spiral outwardly from the art, and I think it would be interesting.
Perfect. Then I'll start from our online presence. we had a website, and one of our motivations for having a website was to have a place to collect stories, and we worked with those stories on the billboards and in our sound installations. But we also wanted to, you know, anorexia and bulimia nervosa and anorexia nervosa and compulsive eating can be a point of shame for people. And when you're in the privacy of your own home, you might be more honest in your reaction to the work than you might be elsewhere. So we wanted to make a body of work that could enter into that domestic space in order to collect those stories, to have a kind of authenticity to them. And also we could have resources and all the kinds of things that you can do on a website, which is not linear. Mm-hmm. And then we had billboards out in the public space because we considered billboards as a vehicle, for instance, that's often utilized as an advertisement venue, and often those advertisements play on the vulnerability of those who may suffer from eating disorders. So what we wanted to do was in those very same venues create a dialogue about the eating disorder itself. So as an example, one of the very first billboards we put up on Highway 80 outside of our capital in Sacramento for California, there's a billboard in flaming flesh. It reads, "Fair fat eats us alive." Photographically, you see these burgers on a grill. And then to the right, it says, "Some women don't just diet, they die." And, you know, when you're creating a billboard, you have about 7 seconds to get your message across. And we wanted to get the message across that, hey, you know, eating disorders take a serious emotional toll on people. Fear fat eats you alive. There's a physical liability with it, mortality. Some women don't just diet, they die. But we needed to say that immediately. And that use of image and text together, that conflation, allowed us to have that kind of versatility in what we're doing. But we also had another plan. And that is, because the Highway 8 is outside of our capital, we were hoping that our legislators would whiz by and see that billboard and take notice. Well,